It is my pleasure to introduce our keynote speaker this morning. Not to my glasses on. If I can read. Rising from a broken home and a challenging childhood, Johnny Kelley found himself in his early 20s. Having earned multiple degrees and certifications in information technology, he has over 12 years of experience in the field. With a lifetime of experience with a disability, Johnny recently discovered a tremendous talent in public speaking. He brings a truly unique perspective and a compelling delivery to issues such as disability awareness, racial equality, self-confidence, and the overwhelming importance of life. I would like to introduce to you a personal friend of mine, Mr. Johnny Kelley.
Good morning, VOTA members.
Good morning.
I'm Johnny. I can't even begin to tell you how happy I am to be here. I'm so grateful to Judith Schoonover for inviting me to speak to all you lovely people this morning. A couple of housekeeping items here before we really get started. Set your phones to vibrate if possible. This computer can be difficult to understand. Even more so if Lady Gaga is singing about her desire. If you haven't already noticed, there are two cameras recording my presentation. The only people who might be caught on film will be people right up front here. Anyone who happens to be in the frame of either camera will be blurred out unless you give me permission otherwise after the presentation. Also, my contact information will be available for you after we finish. We have a lot to cover in 75 minutes. I'm accustomed to speaking for 15, 20, maybe 30 minutes. So saying we have a lot to cover in 75 minutes just sounds absolutely crazy to me. Pastor years ago who would preach for at least a solid hour. I used to wonder how he could do that, because there was no fluff, no flippant, or frivolous stories, no filler. You've got 60 minutes of T-bone steak. You had to loosen your belt by the time he finished. He was the most real person you'd ever meet. I can't promise you'll have to loosen your belt by the time we finish, but hopefully you will burp a few times. Okay, so, a little about me. I am now 34 years old, and I can't see yet another midlife crisis coming at me at warp speed. Every single day I get older, the overwhelming importance of every single day is made that much clearer. I currently live in Midlothian with my wife of 4 years this past September. Her name is Alicia. My computer refuses to say her name correctly. Drives me crazy. She's actually sitting right over here. This is her first time seeing me speak. Always good to see what your husband loves to do. She happens to be a VOTA. How freaking convenient, isn't it? Oh, honey, my back is tight. Could you give me a therapeutic massage? I'm not really like that all the time. She's been a coach for over 5 years now. She loves her work, and she's insanely good at it. She has taken me to work a few times to show off her cute husband. Just kidding, she actually wanted me to consult on patients' wheelchair issues. A wheelchair user as a wheelchair consultant. There's a novel idea. It was fascinating to see her in action. A little more about me. I have spastic cerebral palsy, if that wasn't painfully obvious. I refuse to take any kind of medications. I would rather be alert and spastic than to be doped up and a limp noodle. I think spastic CP is the best disability to have. It's always unpredictable. My wife tells me that I'm always full of surprises. She never knows if my hand on a small on her back is going to be elliptical, or if I'm going to knock her over. And neither do I. I keep our relationship exciting one way or the other. Some people consider me a bit of a computer expert, and I'm more than happy to let them think that. I've been in the field for 13 some odd years, so I better know a little. But lately I find myself less interested in computer stuff. I'm more passionate about speaking and perfecting this craft. In recent years, I've become passionate about the outdoors, roughing it, being off the grid. I find it very satisfying to be in a tent, out in the woods, without a cell phone, TV, internet, or even Facebook. No, he did not just say he would like to be without Facebook. What is wrong with that poor little man? Consequently, I'm also very ecologically minded. My wife, on the other hand, not so much. I drive her nuts turning down the air conditioning and turning off the lights. Add to that my love of weightlifting, and you have a computer geek, / public speaker, / bushman, / gym rat. It's a wonder my head just doesn't explode. If my wife would let me, I'd probably live at the gym. I simply love putting everything I have into the waste. There's nothing like it. I can go in there and just channel all of my aggression and frustration. The weights never judge me for being in a wheelchair. In which I can express myself as a man. I also enjoy playing video games. Now, I don't mean games like Angry Birds or Farmville, although Angry Birds is hilarious. I'm talking about games like Modern Warfare and Battlefield, games where I play online against other people, where I sneak around in my camouflage and pop people in the head without them even knowing where I am. And sending a nice little message saying that they just got sniped by a guy in a wheelchair. That's just me. I was fully aware that I would be sitting in front of a bunch of occupational therapists who would be totally curious as to exactly how I play video games. Therefore, I bought a video. Now this is a video of me running around, like Rambo, taking people out as fast as possible. I'm better at sneaking around like a little wimp and taking my time. But that would be a boring video. It's pretty fun to compete with able-bodied people and actually beat the crap out of them. I'll tell you about the controller I use in just a second. Thank you. I'm going to show you some tools I use in my daily life. I know OT people love to see how we do things and the special tools we use. With that said, I'm going to try to do this rather quickly because we have a bunch of other stuff to cover. I guess the most obvious tool would be this wheelchair. Actually, I'll be talking mostly about my previous chair. It was the same make and model as this one. That was the absolute best chair. She served me faithfully for over 12 years. Bessie was what we called her, and like any other Bessie, she was strong, as an ox, and had the big rear end. My kind of woman. I insist on having a high-end, fast chair. People will say it's safer to go slower than it is to go fast. Not always. You don't want your sweet old grandmother going to cross the street like this. Not a good idea. Back when I was in college, much of the time, I would have to drive my chair to and from class. Round trip of about 10 miles. A good part of the trek was through a not-so-safe neighborhood. Anybody want to take a guess as to how fast I went through that neighborhood? Like a bat in a wheelchair, out of hell. I did this for 3 years, so I perfected the route that I took. I was able to trim it down to about 35, 40 minutes. If you do the math, that comes to about 8 or 9 miles an hour. Now for a power wheelchair, that is just stupid fast. Along with my 3 years in college, braving the weather and dangerous surroundings, I've had countless other adventures in my previous wheelchair. This chair I'm in now is only about 5 years old. She's done pretty well. But like with any first love, you never have another quite like it. I have the ability to tilt and recline. I have personally made some extensive modifications over the years. I have configured the drive settings to my personal preference. I have reprogrammed my seating switch to control the back and the legs separately. I've rotated the switch upside down to prevent me from accidentally hitting it and to protect it from any kind of liquids. I've shortened the overall length of the chair by almost a foot. I've removed the foot plates to shorten the chair even more. Now all I have is little foot base, which is all I need. As you can see, I've attached a few large bags. I like to carry certain items with me. Things like duct tape, rope, matches, an orange garbage bag, a spare wheelchair charger, a toolkit, and last but not least, toilet paper. Okay, onto my Dynabox. This thing costs as much as a used car. It's basically a really fat tablet. It is running Dynabox communication software on top of Windows XP, which means it has the same capabilities of any other Windows computer. It's on a nice daisy mount. In case I want to smooch on my wife, I'm totally accessible. Did I mention this thing is just stupid heavy? Now for my newest tool, / toy. This is my Roshib the Thrive. Other than a few heavy tasks, I can't do everything on here, including communication, in a pinch. If my Dynabox happens to die, my tablet can be a very capable backup. I decided to buy this particular brand of tablet because it's so flexible with all the different ports and the replaceable battery. It's really good for watching movies too. We like to go to Sonic and even the car and watch movies. We watch the movie Make Wall. For those who haven't seen it, the cutest movie ever. Now when my wife calls me, I hear her say this. And I, of course, have to reply. All the women are thinking, that is so sweet. And the guys are thinking, excuse me while I barf. I honestly don't see the resemblance. Do you? Next is my monster of a phone here. This is actually the original Evo. Everybody has seen the Evo. It's a slim little streamlined phone. This is obviously not slim nor streamlined. That's because of two reasons. One being this big fat battery sticking out the back. And two, it has a very thick case on it. I can't drop this on concrete without any problems. I don't know if you can see, but I have Velcro on the back. Normally, this is stuck right here. Very convenient. This is actually one of my foot plates that I bolted onto the frame. Oh yes, I will most definitely rig something up in a heartbeat. Redneck style, baby. Because of the extended battery, I can go 4 days without charging this thing. And like my tablet, this can act as a substitute communication device. Okay, next we have my video game controller. This is the controller I used in the previous video. It isn't in any way designed for people with disabilities at all, but it has the ability to switch button functions. For instance, if button A is the jump button and button B is the punch button, I can switch those and flip-flop those functions. It helps sometimes. It's by far not the perfect tool for the job. These are some of my smaller tools. A non-smalby tool, a small screwdriver, a bottle opener, and a reacher. I probably use a screwdriver the most out of everything here. I use it to open pretty much everything, from soda cans, plastic wrapping, plastic containers, and it also works like a small pry bar. Not to mention, it fits most computer screws. The bottle opener tool is very handy, obviously, for opening bottles and jars. Again, something that wasn't designed for people with disabilities, but it works really, really well. And I decided kind of at the last minute to show you my bathroom. My wife and I have separate bathrooms, and I recommend that for every couple. It's fairly accessible, considering it wasn't designed by someone in a wheelchair. The key tool in my bathroom is this bar. This is a fold-down wrap bar. I love this thing. I ordered it and had our maintenance guys install it. The placement was very important. I wanted it in front of the toilet to create sort of a box. With this wheelchair behind me, it would be very difficult for me to fall. That creates some sense of security in my mind. And when I don't need it, it folds up out of my way. When it's shower time, that same bar becomes a pull point for me when I get out of the shower. The shower bench was also my choice. I wanted the cutout under me for several reasons. The first is because I have absolutely no butt. Consequently, my balance suffers. Having my absent butt sort of in that cutout greatly improves my balance. A lot of the time, my wife isn't home when I decide to take a shower. Feeling stable, safe, and comfortable is crucial when I'm doing that kind of stuff by myself. The second reason for the cutout is for easy access to that specific area of my body. The third reason for that cutout is, say we go out of town. This bench will obviously work in the shower, but more importantly, it will fit over the toilet in case the toilet is too low. It could also suffice as a makeshift toilet, since it has a bucket that fits underneath. So a very important and flexible tool for me. I guess the key to all of these tools is that I chose them myself. That's going to be key for any accommodation you might suggest to your patients. It has to be what they want, or I can promise you they won't use it. Perfect example. I have a very functional zipper hook at home. I can hook it in the zipper handle and zip or unzip my pants. It works just fine, but I never use it.
Yeah. It's
a pain, carrying it everywhere, digging around in my bag trying to find it. So do I just go around with my pants unzipped all the time? Man, I wish it. Talk about being accessible. No, I came up with my own solution. That's a simple zip tie. I can make it as big as I want, cut off the excess, and never have to worry about finding my zipper hook. The zip ties don't melt in the dryer, they won't ever rust, and they're so much cheaper than specialized zipper rings. And I even color coordinated that one. How about that? One more thing. What you might think is appropriate for a patient quite often isn't what they think is appropriate for themselves. Prime example. Where we live, I have a sharp 90-degree turn into my bathroom. As you can see, I can't just swing out wide to make that turn. Rear-wheel drive chairs like mine are notorious for their large turning radius. It might be suggested to me to switch to a mid-wheel drive chair. And that's a very reasonable suggestion. I just don't want to. I dislike mid-wheel drive chairs. I like having the drive wheels right up under. Mine non-existent, but in my opinion, rear-wheel chairs simply ride better. And besides, how else can you pop a wheelie? Now for the good part, the steak and potatoes. How do I live with my disability? I've actually been asked, how could I possibly cope with having such a horrible disability? Really? How can you cope with being such an arrogant prick? I mean, seriously. Here's the thing. I don't cope with my disability. Just as you don't cope with being blonde, brunette, redhead, short, tall, white, black. That's just who you are, right? A wheelchair user is simply part of who I am. I don't know what it's like to walk, so why would I miss it? Why would I feel incomplete never having walked? Now for people who acquire their disability later in life, it's a totally different ball game for them. They remember walking. They remember being able to use both sides of their bodies. They remember being able to talk to people without the awkwardness of using a communication device. They can remember not feeling like a charity case and a second-class citizen. And for a lot of those people, the psychological challenge of feeling somehow broken is their biggest obstacle. I've compiled a short list of requirements that I believe helps in living with a disability. Now, before I show you the first and most important requirement, I want all of you to take a minute and come up with what you think would be the most important necessity for living with a disability. That'll give me a chance to get a drink. I bet you never had a speaker who could drink and talk at the same time. Wasn't that just the stupidest joke you ever heard in your life? All right, you don't have to answer this, but what is the number one necessity for living with a disability? Is it a person like a family member, a caseworker, a therapist, a friend? Is it something spiritual like a religion or a belief in an afterlife free from your disability? That's an interesting thought, isn't it? Is it something as simple as an object like a wheelchair, a walker, a communication device, or maybe it's a service animal? I suppose it all depends on the person and their experiences. If you had asked me that question at a younger point in my life, I might have given a different answer. I might have said a communication device is the most important thing. And I'll tell you why. I'm going to tell you a story that I've never told anyone, not even my own wife. I gotta keep the relationship spicy somehow. This probably isn't the best method, but oh well. in my early 20s, I was in school for business administration. I know. What the hell am I doing public speaking? But one day I'm sitting outside on the college campus waiting on the public transportation. I'm just sitting there minding my business, watching the girls in tight shorts walk by. They had no idea, so why not? Poor little guy in the wheelchair doesn't know where he is, and he probably doesn't even go to this school. He couldn't possibly be checking out my rear end. Fine, whatever. Now every school has this one person, usually a guy, who just creeps everybody out. He even creeps out the guy in the wheelchair who doesn't know where he is. So I'm sitting there watching movies walk by, and I don't see this guy coming. I'm looking over here, just enjoying myself. And all of a sudden, my spidey sense goes off, and I see this guy coming in my general direction, about 20, 25 yards. Now I can't go hide somewhere else, because the very second I leave the bus stop, the bus will pull up. That's a law of nature. So I'm stuck there. Let me pause here and tell you this. I actually owned the Dynavox at that point. However, at that particular time, it was being repaired for the 197th time, literally. You can ask me more about that later. So I'm trying to figure out a way to make myself less inviting. So I open up my algebra book and start reading. Now, who actually reads an algebra book? I mean, seriously. I keep looking up and seeing him getting closer and closer. So I start reading more intently. It is so not working. Now, there are three benches around me. I'm sitting beside one bench. There's one over here. And then another one over here. Anybody want to guess where he's at? And not even comfortably beside me. No, he sat close enough that our thighs touched each other. Now let me pause here again. Normally, if you sit down next to someone, you might say something like, "Hi, how are you today?" Or maybe you'd ask who I'm taking for algebra this semester. Or maybe even, "When's the bus due to arrive?" Oh, but no, I have to attract a weirdo. He looks at me with a straight face and asks me, "So what color underwear are you wearing?" What do you say to something like that? More importantly, if you ask that question, can you be dumb enough to ever expect a positive answer? Apparently so. Now at this point I was feeling several emotions all at the same time. I'm obviously shocked that this weirdo just asked me the color of my underwear. I'm angry for obvious reasons, but I'm also a bit confused. I have just switched to boxers, so I honestly didn't know what color underwear I was wearing. For some reason, that really, really concerned me. So at that point in time, a way to tell that guy to either go somewhere, or I would run over him, that would have probably been the most important necessity to me. But on a more serious note, for me, the most important thing is confidence in myself. Sounds way too simple, but if I can't find self-confidence, then I believe my life matters. Then I believe that I'm supposed to be here. Not only that, I'm supposed to be here just as I am. Then I believe that if I wasn't in a wheelchair, the world would be missing something special. That totally dismisses the possibility that I am, in fact, broken, defective, damaged, impaired, flawed, inadequate. Confidence says, if I want, I can write the next bestseller. I can be the next Bill Gates. I can do whatever I want to do. Having that mindset is 99% of the battle. Confidence, I cannot possibly overstate how important it is. This isn't really part of my normal speech, but I think. Actually, I'm absolutely sure that you as therapists can begin to instill confidence, especially in your younger patients. If you take nothing else away this morning, remember this. More than any adaptive aid you get for them, more than any contraption you make for them, more than any stretching or strengthening they may gain with you, more than any clever technique you teach them to perform an ADL, the greatest, most useful tool you can instill in your patients is confidence, making them see that despite the loss of their use of their left side, despite their blindness, their deafness, despite the loss of one or more limbs, despite being in a wheelchair, despite not being able to talk, despite being constantly misunderstood, underestimated, looked over, ignored, disregarded, disrespected, despite all those things, making them see that they matter. They matter to the course of human history. My wife tells me that I have a way with words, but I could sit up here for the next 20 years, and I still couldn't convey to you how important confidence is. I hate saying, despite being in a wheelchair, or despite missing a limb, or despite being blind. It's like saying, well, despite the way God made you. And that's just dumb. We should say, because you're in a wheelchair, because you're blind, because you can't talk, because of those things, you matter. I can remember in my late teens and early 20s, had a SLP. I had moved into a rehabilitation facility called Roosevelt Institute. It's the facility that our late President Franklin Roosevelt founded. My 18 months there were beyond all words. Anyway, I had just gotten my first Dynavox, and it was obviously my speech pathologist's job to train me on the device. She was probably in her late 20s or early 30s. She was definitely a hottie. She could make a man want to get up and walk around the room. That's kind of a wheelchair inside joke. What made her so attractive, especially to me, besides having an absolutely insane body, was that she was so comfortable with me. She was a touchy-feely kind of woman. I love those types of women. She had no problem hugging me or putting her arm on my shoulder while we programmed my Dynavox. You might think that was totally inappropriate and unprofessional. Granted. But here's the thing. Back then, I wasn't the man that I am now. Boy, that's an understatement. Back then, I had absolutely no confidence in myself. I thought I was ugly, unattractive, boring, and worthless. That was ingrained in me by my family from as far back as I can remember in numerous ways. Now, I have this gorgeous woman actually enjoying my company, so much that I would hang out with her at her house. She made some mean barbecue. I like to think she knew that she could have a greater role in my life than just showing me how to use this thing. I like to think she could see my lack of self-confidence, and she knew how to at least start fixing it. I know it sounds horribly shallow, but it really isn't if you think about it. It's simply showing someone, like me, that they are indeed worthy of being cared about, wanted, needed, and vital to someone else. That is pretty powerful. My wife tells people that her husband was born at Roosevelt Institute. That's a pretty profound statement. She also has a way with words. But once you find confidence in yourself, as a person with a disability, you need to find people who will support you. People who have a vested interest in your well-being, whether that be family, friends, or co-workers. You have to have people that care about you and are willing to help when the need arises. And I can promise you the need will definitely arise, repeatedly. Not for me, of course. My wife is my single biggest support. And I think that's how it should be. But I have numerous other friends that I can call if I need anything. These women work at a rental office where I live. Very sweet women, and I love them to death. The one on the right, Christy, is my adopted mother. I believe some women are just built to be mothers. She is definitely one of them. Yes, that is an advantage of being cute and disabled. You can't just go around adopting people. If I need anything, I can just call, text, or ride up there, and they always have my back. This lady here, Denise, I call her my Porta Freakin' Angel. I met her through another friend, Jeanette, who used to work at a rental office. Denise needed her computer fixed, so I went over to her apartment, and we instantly clicked. And yes, I did fix her computer. She used to work part-time as our housekeeper and my personal caregiver. She was worth so much more than what we could pay her. She had to quit because of health reasons, but we still hang out often, and if I ever need her, she's there. These are just a few of the people I have in my support system. So how do I develop such a support system? It goes back to confidence. There's that word again. If I didn't engage those lovely women at the rental office, they wouldn't know who I am. Why would they want to support me? If I had not had the confidence to show up at Denise's house, I wouldn't have ever met her. If I had been told my wife that I could love her more than any other man on the planet, we wouldn't be married, and I definitely wouldn't be sitting in front of 200-plus people today speaking about confidence. The next thing you need is to find yourself. A lot of able-bodied people have a problem with this because they try to live up to society's expectations, and they find out too little too late that that is completely impossible. We are constantly bombarded with the supposed image of a perfect person. It's not just the perfect body, although that is a big part of it. It goes far, far beyond that, doesn't it? Not only do you have to have the perfect hair, the perfect face, the perfect chest, the perfect abdominals, the perfect butt, the perfect legs, even the perfect feet. I'm never going to look like that guy. Why should I want to? Because that's the perfect body, right? Who says that's the perfect body? Popular society. All of the popular magazines. Those godforsaken soapboxes. I hate those things. People waste their entire lives concerned with and even worried about fake people who only exist for 45 minutes on weekdays instead of living their own real lives. Why do we do that? I think it's because they look like that, perfect. We will never be perfect. These pictures of these people were most likely airbrushed, silicone, spray-on tan, concealing makeup. 10 years from now, they won't even look that good. Now let me say this. I applaud the West for better health. Be as healthy and as fit as possible. But trying to look like these people, or anyone else for that matter, it's a slap in the face to the one who designed and created you. But like I said, it goes beyond physical appearance. You have to have that well-paying job, that perfect house, that nice car. You have to hang around certain people, have certain friends, be popular and powerful. All of this nonsense. But tell me something. Who regulates what's perfect? Who determines what's beautiful? Who oversees what's sassy? Who legislates the standard for the perfect house, the perfect job, the perfect spouse? Far more importantly, who dictates what you can do with your life? There's a little piece of meat for you to chew on. Who dictates what you can or can't do with your life? We can look throughout history. When a powerful minority, whether it's a single person or a regime, tries to control and oppress a less powerful majority, it never works very well. And the person doing the controlling usually ends up dead. Ask Hitler. Now, this isn't the classic definition of a dictatorship, but if you don't measure up to this opinion of perfection, you are considered inferior. Your life somehow means less. Do you know what I say? Bullcrap. Can I actually say that? Too late to ask now. Hi, you look exactly the way you are supposed to look. Hi, you look exactly the way you are supposed to look. You kind of get the idea. I look exactly the way I'm supposed to look. I am exactly who I'm supposed to be. My point is that a person with a disability has to find out who they really are and then proudly be that person. And if society doesn't approve, then society be damned. Life is way too short to fake your way through. All right, everybody fasten your seatbelts. We're about to get into some serious stuff here. In finding myself, in finding out who I am as a person, I found out that I could really enjoy sex. The women in here are thinking, oh dear God, make him stop. They're thinking, isn't it time for like a bathroom break or something? Can someone pull his battery out? I promise to be quick. And that's a good comment. Who knew that someone using the computer to speak could still put his foot in his mouth? The question you have to ask yourself is, did he plan to say that, or did he actually goof up? I recently spoke to a class of ODR students at VCU. I was told that they only received one lecture during their entire program on this subject. That is so wrong. Whether or not we try to avoid it like the plague, it is of paramount importance. It kind of sustains our species. Just saying, it could be an 18-year-old man that just broke his hip and is in a rehab facility. He might not like talking to his wife all that much, but I bet he misses something else. Or it could be a 19-year-old kid who has been conditioned to think that he is not even a sexual being, that he has absolutely nothing to offer a woman, that the only sexual experience he will have will be the continued molestation by his own family member. That speech pathologist who treated me like any other guy, who showed me innocent, unselfish affection. She made me question myself in a good way. Maybe I wasn't such a horribly disgusting little troll. Maybe I wasn't just a cheap object to be used for someone else's sexual gratification. Maybe there would be someone out there who could possibly find me truly attractive, maybe even sassy. It seems so basic for most people. But that was a serious revelation for me. That single concept, more than all the therapy and all the training I received, propelled me to be the strong, confident person I am today. It sounds very shallow, but there is a very primal need to feel attractive, wanted, validated, and desired in a very intimate way. And it makes no difference whether or not I am in a wheelchair, whether I'm paralyzed, whether I'm missing a limb. I need to feel attractive to someone. Okay, what does this mean for you? When you first saw me, what did you think about me? You probably started diagnosing me. Let's see, he has CP, spastic, very high tone, looks like knee contractures. Maybe you even noticed that my left wrist is fused. How many of you saw me as just another man? How many of you saw me as a strong, virile, powerful man? Why not? Goes back to that perfect image. We let society tell us what's attractive, hot, or sexy. When people see me for the first time, especially women, they never see me as a sexual man. And consciously or unconsciously, that is how women choose their mate. If a man is big, strong, good looking, he's a potential mate. I met my wife online in a chat room. I asked her one day if she had met me in the real world, would she have given me a chance? She started crying because she had to say no. That's human nature, I think. Is it unfair? Absolutely. I'm going to demonstrate my point. Right now, I'm going to need a female to assist me in a little demonstration, and I get to pick the one I want. Now, who do I want? Will you help me? Just as a side note, how much confidence would it take to approach a woman who is this beautiful? I'm going to tell you something that you may or may not believe. Please keep in mind, this is just from my personal experience. This may not be the case universally, and I don't know if it applies to women in my situation either. Okay, for this demonstration, you are not in the rehab field. You have no experience with people with disabilities. You're just the average hottie off the street. That didn't come out right either, did it? Anyway, over here you have a normal able-bodied woman. Over here, you have a guy with a severe disability, cerebral palsy, spina bifida, muscular dystrophy, whatever. Any kind of disability that makes you look deformed. Because why? We always judge people first on, not necessarily on their appearance, but on our opinion of their appearance. Very important. This is not the case of a guy, say, a paraplegic. It could be some little boy band reject that got in an accident. He's disabled in a wheelchair, but he's still a pretty boy. It would still be difficult for him, but nowhere near as hard as for someone with a severe physical deformity. If I meet this beautiful young lady out in the real world, there is a gulf or a chasm between us. That gulf is simply my appearance and what it supposedly represents. I don't care if I'm sitting this close to her. There is still an emotional, a psychological barrier between us. In her mind, I'm not a man. I'm basically a charity case. I'm someone who constantly needs help. I'm someone to be pitied. And I'm probably not even aware of my surroundings, or that I'm just partway too close to her. Anybody want to date someone like that? She isn't aware that behind the seemingly restricted computer, cumbersome wheelchair, and this abnormal body, that there is actually a man. She doesn't understand to wait for me to type out what I want to say. All she knows is this little retarded guy has just parked his wheelchair way too close to her. She isn't going to sit there long enough to figure out that I am, in fact, typing an intelligent message to her. And I don't mean, what color underwear are you wearing? Please don't tell me what color underwear you're wearing. I feel a little awkward. But with that said, this may sound totally stupid to you, but from my experience, the only thing that bridges that gap is if this woman finds out that this little handicapped guy can't have sex. All of a sudden, she is thinking of me in a totally different light. In her mind, I went from a little helpless crippled guy in a very cumbersome wheelchair. Now, at the very least, she either wants to know more about me, or she is disgusted by the very thought. At least I have a 50-50 chance, as opposed to just being a helpless crippled guy with absolutely nothing to offer her. And even better, if she finds out I'm really good at having sex, she becomes very curious, and there is nothing more attractive or addictive than a curious woman that allows me to come over here and be close to her in every way. I can sit here and make her laugh. I can't touch her hand as a real man. Over here, I couldn't do that because she only saw this wheelchair and whatever this thing. She didn't see my sense of humor. She wasn't aware that I am, as my wife says, ridiculously intelligent. She didn't see my masculinity because, hell, she probably didn't think I had it. But here's the problem, and I never recommend doing this. Seriously, don't try this. Hi, my name is Johnny, and if you have sex with me, your screams of ecstasy will crack the very sky. It's a pretty good line, just not the best opener. This conversation is going to end rather rapidly with a slap across my face. Do you see the dilemma? Poor guys like me, most women won't consider us until they find out that we are actually men, that we have a masculinity, that we are sexual. But if we try telling them that in order to keep them from running away, it freaks them out and destroys any possibility of relationship. So guys like me are forced to meet women online. Online, this whole thing with the gulf and trying to bridge that gulf is irrelevant. She can't see me. I can be as funny, as wit, as romantic, and as intelligent as I want without worrying about convincing her of my manhood. And when I choose, I can tell her of my disability. If she decides to bail out, that's fine. But I can't show her the real me before she has to face the disability. It is unfortunate, but initially, the woman has to overlook, ignore, and endure my disability. Rather than respect, embrace, and enjoy it. Thank you so much for your help. Jackpot when I found my wife. She had to go through the same process of facing my disability, looking to it, and then finding it acceptable. Just like all of you, she had the advantage of already being aware of disabilities. She was halfway through her OT program when we met. But now I'm just her husband. She doesn't have to ignore my disability. Rather, she loves it. I don't think she would rather I be normal. I honestly don't think I would be as attractive to her if I was normal. That sounds strange, but I think that's exactly how it should be. Not just accepting, but cherishing my disability. Some people are curious as to what our marriage is like. I promise you, it's just like every other marriage. I'll give you a perfect example. My wife takes me shopping. Lane Bryant, Ashley Stewart. It's time, Mark, Pottery Barn, Hobby Lobby. My wife has a purse this big, and it's pink. I don't mean acute, soft, subtle, pink. I'm not. Oh my goodness, I can't see her coming from 15 miles away. Who gets the privilege of carrying the purse? To complete the ensemble, she has a pink sweater. The same awesome shade of pink. So I have the pink purse and the pink sweater, and I'm right behind my wife as she shops. I'm not paying attention to the stylish yet tasteful blouses she is looking at. I'm looking at my phone. All of a sudden, I look up. So I'm sitting there with a pink Samsonite hanging off the back of my chair. And the pink sweater in my lap. I call my wife, and it goes straight to voicemail. Because, of course, I have a signal, and she doesn't, and we're in the same freaking store. So I text her, "Where are you?" She says, "I'm over by the decorative scarves." That's not freaking helping me. Marco! Now that's a normal marriage right there. Couple more things here concerning sex. Some curious people will want to know about the logistics of sex with disabilities. There's really no magic formula. It's basically about experimentation and having a lot of fun. There might be a pillow over here, or the person may need help into a particular position. It really isn't that different. And the last thing, I would assume that this would be the case for anyone with spastic cerebral palsy. But for me personally, having an orgasm is better than any muscle relaxer on the market. If you can get past the grossness factor, it makes perfect sense. Every muscle tenses up for, I don't know, 10, 15 seconds, and there's a big release. And yes, that's my orgasm face. So what's your role in this? This is just my opinion here. You obviously won't be able to physically facilitate these activities with your patients. Rather, I believe a therapist's main role is not physically fixing people. I believe your greatest contribution is disseminating information. That can be your role concerning sex and your patients. Telling them, regardless of disability, that it is in fact possible and a lot of fun. Tell them about the health benefits. For me, it's the best cardio ever. Which brings me to another point. Most people think people like me can only just lay there. The other person has to do all the work. That could not be further from the truth. My wife probably wants to hide under her chair right about that. But I don't think it's something to be ashamed of. It's one of the best parts of life. That brings me to the last necessity for living with a disability. I have to live my life. This used to be just a wrap-up point for me to close my presentation. But in the past year, especially in the past couple months, this concept, by and large, has revolutionized the way I live my life. Ever have an ideology just knock you upside the head like a baseball bat? Happened to me. Whether or not you believe in a heaven or a hell, whether or not you believe that when we die, our spirits remain here on earth affecting those who are still alive, whether or not you believe in reincarnation, or whether or not you believe that when you die, you simply cease to exist, whether or not I believe in an afterlife is irrelevant enough here and now. It doesn't matter if I will have a golden castle full of treasures beyond all comprehension when I die. It doesn't matter if I'll have 200 virgins or my own planet or whatever else we think we will have when we die. None of that matters. I am living in this very moment on this planet. I'm not living 5 seconds ago or 100 years from now. What am I doing in this time? Am I enjoying myself? Am I making memories? Am I learning something? Whose life am I impacting in a positive way? Am I making a difference? I often ponder the meaning of life and all of its intricacies. My wife will tell you that I sit and think way too much. I think it boils down to a question of purpose. Without purpose, life is indeed pointless. And I don't think anyone can tell you what your purpose is. I don't think you can find it in any book or at any seminar. I think you simply find out whatever makes you happy. This is my purpose. This makes me happy. Sitting up here in front of intelligent people, enlightening them on disability issues, giving them a different perspective, inspiring them, even just making them laugh, I found my purpose. I found what I want to do with the rest of my life. This is the work that I hope will make my wife and maybe our future children proud of me. This is how I will leave my mark on the world. It took me, 33 years to find my purpose. Sure, I could be consumed with regret that I didn't find it earlier in life. But some people never find their purpose. They live out their years, work a dead-end job, maybe have children, maybe even die wealthy, but they never found that one thing that drives them, that thing that excites them, that one single thing that fulfills their life. It's nice that we can make a living fulfilling our purpose, but it really doesn't matter if we die penniless, if we are doing what we love. We may be 50, 60, even 70 years old. Doesn't matter. Find your purpose now. After you find your purpose, you can use it to be pivotal. Last year I spoke to that class of OT students that were about to start their first fieldwork assignments. Dr. Tony Gentry, who is a professor of OT at VCU, he is the reason why I'm sitting in front of you today. He took time out of his busy day, made contact with, I'm assuming, Ms. Judith, recommended that I not only speak here, but to keynote the whole conference. This is the biggest speaking engagement I've ever done, by far. I guess when someone like Tony recommends you take the batter's box, you try to knock the ball into the next zip code. It's the same with Miss Judith. She didn't know me from Adam. All she had was Tony's recommendation. That speaks to his credibility, but more so to Judith's open-mindedness, to give an OT like me a chance to make my impact. To individuals making a positive impact on who knows how many. These are some people who have influenced the way I live my life. Albert Einstein. He revolutionized our understanding of the laws of physics, the photoelectric effect, which was pivotal in establishing quantum theory. My fascination with physics, quantum mechanics, and such things doesn't necessarily mean that I'm smart. It probably just means I'm weird. Everybody knows this guy, Stephen Hawking, the most well-known scientific mind of our time. While I don't agree with all of his theories, I respect the man for his incredible intelligence and his conviction for what he believes. He's a perfect testament to sheer determination. Whether you like him or hate him, President Roosevelt led us out of the Great Depression and led us to victory in the Second World War. But for me personally, he was pivotal in my life for founding the rehab facility in Warm Springs, Georgia. If he hadn't, I wouldn't have ever gone. I wouldn't have ever become the man, the husband, I am today. This man's struggle for racial equality resonates with me. I fight for the same equality, but my fight isn't about skin tone. It's a fight for equality across all ability levels. The idea is that I am equal to the able-bodied person. I am as needed. I am as necessary. I am as vital. I deserve no less respect. My life is as significant as anyone else's. I think that man would agree with that idea. What do you think? Miss Rosa Parks. She taught me to demand respect, to demand equality. You might find this totally strange, but there are people who can't accept that I am equal to them. Again, it perfectly parallels the racial bigotry between white and black people. If I am an able-bodied person, albeit ignorant, and if someone tells me that this little seemingly retarded person over here is equal to me, in my ignorant mind, that makes me less of a person. I can't accept that. I won't accept that. It hurts my pride. I'm supposed to be the epitome of what it means to be human. I deserve the best of everything because, in my opinion, I'm normal. All this little guy over here deserves is to be tolerated as a second-class citizen and supported by my tax dollars for the rest of his insignificant life. That sounds harsh, but trust me, I've seen it all my life. So did she. Some of you will recognize this guy, Les Stroud, the survivor man. He was the guy who piqued my interest in the outdoors, camping, learning survival techniques. He inspired me to have my own adventures, to venture out of my comfort zone, to live my life to the fullest. He has to be one of my heroes. This woman here, my wife, I could talk about her all day. That would just make her cry and ruin her makeup. But I will simply say that she makes me want to be a better man. Isn't that just the prettiest dog you ever saw in your life? I really don't even know how to tell you this. So I'll just say it. 2 months ago, I lost this beautiful girl to renal failure. Her name was Bree. She was a pure English lab, and she had just turned 6. Isn't she gorgeous? Something I found that works for me. Sticking your tongue out helps you to keep from crying. I promise I won't be offended. She was something else. She had the best personality, so playful and so gentle, especially with kids. Sweetest, most lovable dog you'll ever meet. May of last year, my wife was working at a nursing facility in Farmville. She disliked many things about the facility, but the administrator needed someone to adopt Bree. His 3 kids were growing up, very busy with after-school activities, and they did not really have time for Miss Bree. One of the other therapists mentioned Bree to my wife. We decided to keep her while her family went on vacation, just to see how it went. We never gave her back. She was already trained to perform the normal commands: sit, down, stay, come, shake. I taught her a few things. I taught her how to walk with me on my left side, watching me for when I make left turns. I taught her to stop automatically when I stopped my chair and to move when I move. And yet all the training I did with her, all the things that I taught her, nothing compares to the incredible lessons that she taught me. The first thing she showed me was a truly blind eye to my disability. It was the most beautiful thing. When she wanted to go out, who did she come to? Dad. When she was hungry, sometimes she wouldn't eat unless I hold her food in my hand and let her eat out of my hand. When she wanted to play, when she wanted to go for a run, when she wanted her booty rubbed, she came to me. She had no idea that running with me was any different. All she knew was Daddy was running with her and that she was happy. She had absolutely no apprehension, no uneasiness, no uncertainty, no anxiety about obligating me to uphold my end of our relationship. Discrimination, bigotry, preconceived notions, any excuses due to any extenuating circumstances, none of that had any meaning to her. The concept that I was disabled, or even just different, never even entered her mind. If we played tug-of-war, worrying about pulling me out my wheelchair is the absolute last thing she was concerned with. Daddy is playing with her. That was the only thing on her mind. I was her dad, her master, her pack leader, whatever you want to call me. The disability, the wheelchair, the speech impairment, the spasticity, none of it had any bearing on our relationship. That had to be the most beautiful relationship. It had to be probably 5, 6, 7 months after she adopted us. It started to dawn on me that this dog had absolutely no concept of yesterday or tomorrow. Last week, next month, next year, 10 years from now, none of that had any meaning in her beautiful mind. Sometimes she and I would sit and stare in each other's eyes, and I could tell she was 110% focused on that very moment. Nothing else mattered to her in that moment. She wasn't frustrated over whatever happened earlier that day. She wasn't making any plans for tomorrow. All she knew was in that very moment. What a way to live. She also taught me to take every opportunity to help someone, to make someone smile, to brighten someone's day, or to just experience something new, even if it is out of your way, even if it involves a lot of work, even if it cuts into your personal time, even if it's something totally new and totally outside your comfort zone. Do it. It's a safe bet that you won't have that opportunity again. Experience the experience. I made that up, or at least I think I made that up. My wife has a tendency of staying on the beaten path, not taking chances, not trying new things, staying well within her comfort zone for fear of not liking what she finds outside. I tell her, when she has an opportunity to do something that she may or may not enjoy, go for it. If she tries it and doesn't like it, fine, she'll go for sure. If she never tries it, she might be denying herself something. That could bring her a lot of joy. I think we had to go outside of our comfort zone when we took Bree. Imagine the incredible blessing we might have passed up if we hadn't taken that chance. I guess the last thing Bree taught me happened when we found out she was sick and she wouldn't have long to live. Initially, she was oblivious to the fact she only had a short time left. She obviously knew she was sick. But when her time was drawing near, I could see in her eyes that she knew, and yet she still tried to be her sweet, inviting, playful self, even though it was totally obvious that it was a struggle for her to do so. Now I have no idea if she was doing that for our benefit, or if that was just the way she was. I like to think my baby was being a trooper for us. Nonetheless, the lesson was clear, at least to me, put everything you have into every moment. Enjoy it. I figured we would have Bree for another 10 years. 10 years of running, playing, laughing, loving. 10 years of going to sign, and all of us having a burger and fries. 10 years of memories. There is a quote in one of my favorite episodes of Star Trek. Make now the most important time, because now will never come again. None of us will ever be right here, right now, ever again. Are we living in this moment like my Bree baby did? Okay, go back to all of these people and K9. All of them have had their impact on human history. Most of them are in history books. Most of them are famous and renowned for their accomplishments. A couple of them are relatively unknown until today. The question that I pose to you is this: what is the difference between these famous people and you? What makes these people more important than you or me? What makes these people more pivotal to history than you or me? You see, we think greatness is reserved for certain people, certainly not us. Not so. Greatness is a choice. You don't have to be president. You don't have to be a famous scientist. You don't have to be a genius. You don't even have to be an astronaut. Greatness isn't about that. Greatness is simply making an impact, making a difference. This is how I make my impact. This is how I make a difference. This is how I will be remembered. You have the opportunity every day you go to work to make an impact, to make a difference. One patient at a time. despite your working conditions, despite the pressure from your employers, despite the insane amount of regulations and paperwork. Every single one of you is capable of greatness. Take a look at this list again. Is there anything on this list that you yourself don't need? Everybody needs confidence. Everybody needs people they can count on. No one is an island unto himself. Dr. Martin Luther King said that we are caught in an inescapable web of mutuality. Everybody needs to find themselves, and everyone needs to live their life to the fullest. I'm basically saying that everything I need to live with my disability, you also need to live without a disability. Why do I have to cope with having a disability? Why is having a disability always seen as a disadvantage? Why can't I just enjoy being me? I am not broken. I am not inferior. I am no less important. I am no less necessary. My life is no less worthy of respect. I am meant to have cerebral palsy. Let's do this. If I was normal, do you think I would be sitting here talking to you today? Do you think I'd be giving you this little speech? I wouldn't care about disability issues. I'd probably be married to someone I didn't love. I'd probably have 4 or 5 ill-mannered kids running around. I'd probably be at some dead-end job. I wouldn't be happy. I wouldn't be making a difference. How many of you are going to forget me anytime soon? How many of you are going to take something positive away from today? What more could I want? I want to thank you for listening to me.